Without further introductions, I will just start with my topic. And since I'm known to most of the guys here as a fob, I'm fresh off the boat. I like boat examples. So I would like to just paint a picture in your head of a boat, big ship. And imagine that ship that's huge, humongous, bigger than the Titanic, but there's no Leo there. This ship is actually in the middle of the ocean, thousands of miles away from the nearest land. This ship is going with no purpose, no direction, just wandering. If you zoom in, if you just try to start zooming in into that scene, you'll see that the ship is full of holes, and water is leaking into the ship, and the ship is drowning and drowning, but people on board are not aware of what's going on. This ship is the ship of humanity. At the year 600 after Christ. This is the ship of humanity before Muhammad was sent to people. Let's zoom into the first level of the ship. You have a civilization like the Roman Empire. Amazing warfare, technology, advanced mansions, everything, amazing. But if you zoom in, you will see that this society was very inhumane. They were very violent. They used to enjoy, and we all know, and we all read history. They used to enjoy watching, you know, all the rich and all the kings, enjoy watching slaves being eaten alive by lions. They're watching, that's their form of entertainment. Now we watch TV, then they used to watch just innocent people being killed for no reason. If you look at their warfare and their manners of war, they were very violent. And the way they treated their war prisoners, for example, history tells us that when the Romans, they surrounded Jerusalem, and the Jews were in Al-Quds, and the Jews, you know, they surrendered to the Romans. So they wanted to kill them. But they did not kill them in an honorable way. So they gave every man a sword, and they told him, the only way to keep you alive is when you kill your own wife and children in front of us. They enjoyed watching that. And after that, so those men, they were aware, they just wanted to get, you know, to live. So they killed their own wives and children. And after that, they made a draw between two Jewish men, and whoever wins will kill the other person. That was the Roman civilization. So that was on the upper deck of that ship of humanity, and every time they oppress a human being, they are poking more holes into that ship. And the ship is drowning and drowning and drowning. Let's go to the second level. You have the Persian civilization. Again, they were rivals to the Romans. They were always, you know, competing. But again, they had a lot of oppression and a lot of injustice to human beings. If you look at the Persians, for example, they had some kind of a philosophy where it was very similar to communism. So everything is a shared property. Wealth, women, everything is shared. So you can go and enjoy whatever you want from other, from your neighbor, his wife, his daughter, his mother, it doesn't really matter. And that was something very, you know, ugly, very filthy in the Persian civilization. Although they had something else, they were very racist. So the slaves and the soldiers, they had no value. It was well known in the Persians, in their wars, like they have their fighters, and they would chain the fighters, every 20 soldiers, into one chain. Why? So that those soldiers will not run away from the battle. And when the Muslims were fighting with the Persians, it was an easy battle, just because, you know, they were... Because for the Persian emperor and king, he doesn't care about the life of his people. That was the second level. Let's go to the lowest level of the civilization on the ship of humanity in year 600. And that was the Arabs, Arab nation. They are not even a country. They are just a bunch of tribes fighting each other. And subhanAllah, we all know what they used to do. It was very justified for them, for any tribe to go and attack another tribe and just kill them and own their women as slave and what have you. And you know, burying women alive. When we talk about burying women alive, it's not the dead who does it, it's the criminal. It's not only him. It's others who pat on his back and say, oh, good job, you buried your daughter today, good job, you're the man. So it was a community. And by doing this, they are sinking. The ship of humanity is going nowhere. And it's sinking, and water leaks is going everywhere. This is why the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ tells us about that incident. that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looked at all human beings at that time, at year 600 after Christ, with hate, with anger, and hated all of them except some remainings from the people of the book. Some individuals here and there, but they don't really count. Let's zoom in a little further, and then we watch, see that man. He's in his late 30s, sitting in the cave, reflecting, thinking, enjoying the solitude, enjoying being alone and reflecting on the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hadith says, حُبِّبَ إِلَيْهِ الْخَلَاءِ. He enjoyed just being alone, staying away from people, and being in the company of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whom he doesn't know yet. Now, subhanAllah, this makes me think, and for everyone to think here, what about our moments of privacy, when we are alone? How do we spend it? What do we think? What is the first thing that comes to mind when I tell you someone is alone? Unfortunately, many people use that, you know, go to the bedroom and do something, and go to your smart or dumb phone, whatever, and do something there. People travel to a different city just because, you know, they make sure that no one is there so that they can sin. The Prophet ﷺ enjoyed the moment of solitude with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the hadith حُبِّبَ إِلَيْهِ الْخَلَاءِ. Allah made it more beloved to him being alone and secluding himself from people. Now again, this is not only about the Prophet ﷺ. It's about us here in 2013. What does Allah tell us? SubhanAllah, this hadith reminds me of the ayah,
وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ حَبَّبَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْإِيمَانِ وَزَيَّنَهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ.
Allah made the iman more beloved to your hearts. Allah made our hearts, even if you think you are a big sinner, Allah made your heart thirsty for iman.
وَكَرَّهَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْكُفْرَ وَالْفُسُوقَ وَالْعَصْيَانِ.
Allah made you hate sinning and disobeying Allah. You hate it, even if it's attractive from the outside. Allah made it more beloved to you, you just have to take the extra step. This ayah reminds me about a person that I know personally. This guy, he had some attraction towards the same gender. In other words, he was homosexual. In other words, he was gay. And I say, not gay as in happy, gay as in gay. This guy, making dua to Allah, because I found, you know, some poster outside talking about homosexuality in Islam and stuff, and I don't know what perspective, but I think it's important to know that this guy had this struggle, but he did not surrender to it. He did not say, you know, it's my genes, Allah gave me with this, blah, blah, blah. He struggled, and he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he kept on fighting for years. Kept on fasting, trying different stuff, you know, keeping himself busy. Later on, subhanAllah, the guy woke up one morning, وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ حَبَّبَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْإِيمَانِ وَزَيَّنَهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. SubhanAllah, it was wiped out completely. This guy now is married with kids. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who makes sin hated in your heart, but you just have, you should take the extra step. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah made it more beloved to him to take the extra step and seclude himself from people. And this was the first actually worship in Islam where he actually did seclude himself and reflect on stuff. What was he thinking about? Sitting in that cave, what was he thinking? I mean, the scholars try to interpret, there's no authentic hadith, what was he thinking about? But the scholars have, they are trying to read in between the lines, he was having two ideas in mind. The first one, the personal questions. Who created me? Where am I going to go? You know, what about my kids? My kids, they died while little young. Where are they right now? My parents, why did they die? Why was I raised as an orphan? About my kids, is there anyone who's gonna remember me after I die? Because you know, at that time, if someone has no male children, you will never be remembered. So these are all questions. I have been living for 40 years, almost 40 years. What did I do? What is the purpose of my life? Question after question after question. Another dimension, the Prophet ﷺ was a human rights activist. He did a lot of stuff for the humanity. He took part of a non-discrimination organization, you can call it, called Hilf al-Mutayyibin, where him and other Hashimis, other people of his tribe, they made an oath, and they immersed their hands into a jar that was full of perfume. That was their, you know, gang way of doing, you know, making an oath. And they swear by Allah and and that they will help everyone regardless of his nationality, regardless of being Qurashi or non-Qurashi, regardless of being Arab or non-Arab, we will help them, all of them. He was part of that organization. He freed some slaves. He helped some poor people. But subhanAllah, you know when you are trying to patch some holes into the ship of humanity that we talk about? But what about the whole ship? What about the whole, the direction of that ship? Where is it going? Where is it heading? Thinking and thinking and thinking. You know, let me give you an example. All of us have been into, you know, like fundraising dinners. Anyone has been to a fundraising dinner before? Oh my God, you know, in this community, mashallah, I know there's a lot of dinners going on. And that agency or relief organization, they give an annual report where they tell you that, for example, last year we fed 1,000 orphans, this year we're feeding 5,000. And we're helping more needy people, and we built this school and blah, blah, blah. But you, so you are trying to feed the hungry people. But what about hunger? You're trying to help some war refugees. But by the time you are about to help them, another conflict will happen. You're trying to patch holes into that ship, and three other leaks will come in. Human rights activists will become depressed after a while. What's going on? How can I help the whole humanity? This was all happening in the heads of the Prophet ﷺ. You know, now we're living in the US with the most advanced technology and system and what have you. But what about crime prevention? What about fighting crimes? Are we good at it? We have in our country one of the most heinous crimes ever. Why? Because we are not solving the root of the problem. And that was, you know, going into the head of the Prophet ﷺ until the Iqraa moment happened. And when I say the Iqraa moment, I got that idea from the Eureka moment. Anyone who knows what's Eureka? So, what is it about? What's the Eureka moment?
Got it.
It's the aha, oh, I know it. It's the OMG moment. So, it was derived from, you know, Archimedes, the philosopher and the physicist. He was going into a bath, and when he sat into the bath, he noticed that the water level is going up, actually. And so he figured out, he discovered the law of buoyancy from that simple experiment that he did. And he yelled in Greek, Eureka! Which means, oh, I got it! Aha, you know? So from that time, every moment of discovery of something, it became the Eureka moment. I would like, and there are many Eureka moments in history. I would like to humbly say, as a Muslim, I think the Iqraa moment is much more profound, much more powerful. Inshallah, we'll try. And I think, subhanAllah, it's a very good, in the beginning of this conference, to discuss a little bit the Iqraa moment in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Previous prophets came with different miracles. Some of them came with a stick, that Prophet Musa, where he hits into the sea and the sea will be split into two huge parts. So Musa throwing the stick and it will take to become a snake. Another prophet like Prophet Saleh alaihi salam, who had this huge stone and the huge stone turned into a camel, which, you know, challenged the people. The people were amazed, bewildered by it. What about the Prophet ﷺ? We all know that the miracle is the Quran. And I remember one of the Saturday school students was saying, astaghfirullah, maybe I should not say this, but so he was saying that, man, they had all kinds of those cool miracles like a stick and snake and what have you, and now all what we have is a book. You know, that doesn't sound really good, but guess what? This book is living with us. For other miracles, they are only stories that you hear about them. This book is living with you. This book, actually, when you read it, you will become the miracle. You will become the change that you want for the world. SubhanAllah, previous miracles talk to the senses. People were bewildered, astonished by them. This miracle is talking to the heart and to the mind. And when you change your heart and mind, wallahi, you will do miracles in life. So the Iqraa moment. Now, it's interesting to think about it. Why Iqraa? Why wasn't the first command to the Prophet pray? And actually, I don't know this. I have a question. What was the first farad in Islam? And you should know the answer by now. The first farad in Islam is? Pray? No. I think I said it. What is the first farad in Islam? Read. Exactly. So it's not pray. It's not go destroy the idol. It's not go make some, you know, bring a camel and put some bombs on the camel and run this camel into the idols and boom. You know, Allahu Akbar, another 9/11 in Mecca. It was not like that. The first part of Islam was read. It was not do jihad. It was not go and preach your people and give da'wah. Because guess what? Da'wah without Iqra is useless. You will pull people away from Islam because you don't know how to read. Jihad without Iqra is terrorism. It's useless. It's vain. Faith, belief in Allah without Iqra is useless. Why? Because, let me be blunt here, you are not different from any rat or cow worshipper who just believes in something just because their parents believe in it. You need Iqra in your faith. You have to base your faith on a foundation of Iqra. Allah, the Prophet ﷺ says in a beautiful hadith, إِنِّي أَشَدُّكُمْ مَعْرِفَةً لِلَّهِ. I am the one who knows Allah more than anyone of you. وَأَشَدُّكُمْ خَشْيَةً لَهُ. The more I know about Allah, the more I honor Him, the more I fear Him, the more I really worship Him with beauty and everything. The Arabs before Iqra were an illiterate community. They had no means to write and read and do everything. Even their literature, the poetry, it was spoken, it was said, it was not actually written. And Iqra was revealed on an illiterate person, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who didn't know how to read and write. He's an nabi al-ummi. So al-ummi comes from um is what? A mother. So an ummi person is someone who's as illiterate and ignorant as he was when he was born. She was an nabi al-ummi, but it was given to him, and see what Iqra made to the Arab. And what Iqra gave to the Muslims. Less than 100 years after Iqra was revealed, Muslims became the leading civilization in history. They invented a lot, they carried a lot of knowledge. Actually in Europe was living in dark ages. And they had, you know, they had their Christianity and their, you know, church. It was fighting the scholars to the extent that they ended up, you know, burning many of their books. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved that knowledge by the Muslims. So the Muslims went to Europe and they grabbed these books, translated them, and later on many of the scholars from Europe, they had to go on a scholarship trip to Baghdad, to Damascus, to the Muslim world, to Al-Qahira, to learn Arabic language, because this is where the university is. The modern definition of a university started from the Muslims. Even the Ijaz, the PhD system, you know how a professor will give the PhD to another fellow PhD student? It was actually derived from the Ijaz system, where a scholar who's a hafiz of the Qur'an will give the Ijaz and the Qur'an to others. The Muslims are the ones who did all of that. And I'm not saying this so that we just sleep on the, you know, glory of the past and say, man, we were cool, man, we were amazing. Just, you know, that's not the case. It's for us to redirect our direction towards Iqra. If you want to change the humanity as the conference says, you have to start with Iqra. We talk sometimes about imitating the kuffar. And you know, people who are just trying to imitate non-Muslims just to be cool or fun or what have you. Do we have this in our Muslim tradition? Not at all. Do you know why? Because previously the kuffar used to imitate the Muslims. Hindus wear turbans because Muslims wear turbans. We used to be the leading civilization in this. When Europe were filthy and they did not have, you know how, why French people, they have all kinds of perfumes and stuff like that? Because they had a shower probably once or twice a year. So they had to cover that smell with their perfumes. In that time where European people did not have even showers except once or twice a year, Muslims had pipes with faucets in their houses because they have wudu, because their Islam teaches them Iqra and teaches them how to be clean. So subhanAllah, that's why you are here. You are here to start from Iqra and help save the ship of humanity as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did to humanity. SubhanAllah, Iqra was given, and the Quran in the beginning was not even a book. It was oral speech. So the Prophet ﷺ would recite the Quran, and people will hear it, and they would memorize it, and then just recite it back. It was not a book. So it was interesting for Allah to tell Muhammad ﷺ, Iqra, read. Although there's no written book yet. Well, let me tell you the difference between speech and writing. When I'm writing something, I can always correct, I can edit, I can give it to someone else, I can control Z, undo what I'm doing, shift delete, you know, I can start over. They say writing is rewriting. When I'm giving a speech, I cannot do that. If a word comes out of my mouth, I cannot get it back. When I'm giving a speech, I've been talking for probably 20 minutes, and I made a lot of grammatical errors. It's fine because it's a speech, but it's not writing. Well, guess what? The speech of the Quran is a speech, it's not written. But it was amazing, flawless, perfect, with no mistake whatsoever. And this is what baffled the Arabs. How did he come with all of that. And he's illiterate, subhanAllah. So the first Iqra, the first word that was revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's alluding to the fact that this Quran is as perfect as a book because it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another amazing aspect of Iqra. Iqra was revealed at a time where religious information was confidential. You don't have access to your holy book. This was common in the Christian culture, where people, you know, only the Pope and the Cardinal and the clergymen, they have only access to those information. Why? This is how they kept their communities in control. You don't have access, you cannot interpret the Bible, you cannot even read the Bible, we are the ones who will control it. We are the ones who will tell you what to do. And this is how they enslave people's mind. Well, guess what? Islam, from day number one, is telling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is telling every Muslim, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. Read. The book is for you to read and interpret for yourself. There's no middleman between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only middleman between you and Allah is the humble messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he's telling you to go and read back and refer to the Quran yourself. اقرأ. Amazing man. اقرأ. The issue with اقرأ is اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. Read with the name of your Lord. For the sake of your Lord. By the help of your Lord. Don't read purposeless stuff. Someone say, yeah, I read every Harry Potter or Twilight story and mashallah, I read everything. Habibi. Iqra, it might, they say that it might take you 93 years to read what's published in one day only. You might spend a lifetime to read what's published in one day only. So there's a lot of information out there. The idea is Iqra bismi rabbik. Be focused and read something that will benefit you. So let's continue with the ayat, amazing five ayat that's telling us, that's giving us the Iqra moment. So Allah says, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Khalaq al-insana min alaq. Iqra wa rabbuka al-akram. Alladhi allama bil qalam. Allama al-insana ma lam ya'lam. Let me skip for ayah number 4 and then I will go back to ayah number 2. Where Allah said, Alladhi allama bil qalam. Allah is the one who taught with a pen. Allah did not tell us about knowledge in abstract terms. You just go and get knowledge. He's giving us tools. And so he told us, you have to read. There's no shortcut for knowledge. And you have to use the pen. Which is a very interesting statement that Allah is saying, very intelligent in Arabic. They say, ma hufidha farra, wa ma kutiba qarra. So whatever you memorize will run away, will escape from your head. But what you write down will be there. I'm giving you this lecture with some notes that I got from halaqat like 10 years ago. And alhamdulillah, they're still there and I see them. They are part of me. They're part of who I am today. And that's why I'm urging everyone in this room. Please, when you come to such conferences, always have something in your head. Always take down anything. Take some notes. And share these notes with others. Probably you will help someone. Probably you will find an information that might be beneficial to you or to others. So subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, اقرأ, so that you get the knowledge for yourself. And then he's telling us, الَّذِي عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمِ, so that you will write down the knowledge, you will keep it for yourself, and you will share it with others. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave us a beautiful example about the knowledge and how people preserve it and how people waste it. He says that, subhanAllah, the example of the knowledge and the wisdom of the Prophet ﷺ is like abundant rain coming down to earth. So people have different soul personalities. You know, we're created from earth, right? We're created from dirt. So the nature of human beings is very similar to the nature of the land. So he's telling us that one kind of people are like a very fertile piece of land. So when the water comes down, this land will put a lot of plants, a lot of vegetation, a lot of trees, and it will keep some water so that others will benefit from it. Very beneficial, very generous piece of land. It will benefit itself with that rain, with that knowledge, and it will give it to others. That's type one. Type two are people who are very hard, solid ground that will not have any vegetation in it. It's very solid. It cannot put any trees or plants in it, but it can contain the water. It will store and store and store. So someone else will come and drink from that water and benefit from it. That's step number two. Amazing. Beautiful hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. And there's a third type. A piece of land that's not fertile. It will not put any vegetation, and it will not keep any water. It will just lose it. Those are the people who hear from something, and they shift the lead. Send it to recycle bin, and even empty the recycle bin. Don't be from type number three. Try to be from number one. Whatever knowledge you get, benefit from it. At least if you don't think you think you know this stuff, take some notes and share it with others. Tweet those information. Try to hashtag, you know, on Twitter or Facebook and put MMYC. This is something I learned. Not from this lecture, because basically I'm only giving you an appetizer. But you will have amazing speakers who's gonna speak and talk to you. So please share that information, and inshallah you will keep it for yourself. الَّذِي عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمِ SubhanAllah. The scholar said, you know, reflecting on the hadith, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ. The best one among you is the one who teaches the Quran, actually, who learns the Quran, and who teaches the Quran. So the scholars say that the first one who was taught the Quran, the first student of the Quran is who? First student? The Prophet ﷺ. He was getting the Quran from Jibreel. And sometimes he would get the Quran, and he's trying to repeat after Jibreel, and he's speaking in a very quick, you know, tone, and Allah will tell him, لَا تُحَرِّكْ بِهِ لِسَانَكْ لِتَعْجَلَ بِهِ. Don't worry about it. We will let you memorize it. So the first student of the Quran is the Prophet ﷺ. So when you are a student of Quran, you are applying a sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Amazing. An amazing sunnah. Now who is the first one who taught the Quran? Trick question. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. Jibreel. Close. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahman. Allama al-Qur'an. The most merciful. He taught the Quran. So when you are teaching the Quran, you are actually doing a sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Amazing. Please, if you have a paper and a pen, start taking notes. Not now, but later. Prepare yourself always, and at least from every lecture, try to come up with three benefits, with three items. Let's go back. اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. خلق الإنسان من علق. Allah created this human being from this clinging, hanging blood clot. And I'm not going to go to the scientific aspect of it, but it's really amazing, subhanAllah. You know, let me give you an example. Imagine the late Steve Jobs, or someone like his level, telling people, trying to prove to them that I am the one who invented the iPhone 5. And he's telling them, hey, you know what? You can open it, go and, the engineering companies, they do like reverse engineering. So they take it and dissect it. So he'll tell them, go and dissect it and try to reverse engineer it. And probably take your time, and you'll find out that there's a chip, microchip right there, that does this and that. And he will give them a very detailed description. So those other companies, they will take it and dissect it and study it, and after 5 years, oh, you know what, you were right. We found this. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told human beings, 1400 years ago, Allah started our creation from a substance that's hanging on the wall of the womb. Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention our origin of creation? A lot of benefits. The first one is to prove to us that He can resurrect us back to life. The one who created you from that humble mini droplet of sperm can resurrect you back to life again. There's another benefit, is that to humble yourself. Human beings, don't be arrogant. Human beings, you were created from a droplet of sperm that was worthless. That if you see it on your underwear, it's filthy, it's nasty. And you became who you are. So a droplet of sperm will later on become an arrogant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A droplet of sperm will later on refuse to make sujood to Allah. A droplet of sperm later on will be arrogant on their parents. Human beings, humble yourself. Remember who you are. You were nothing. You were worthless. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who raised you. اقرأ وربك الأكرم. Allah is the one who gave you honor, who gave you dignity. So the first reason for mentioning our origin is what? Can someone remind me? Someone who's taking notes? Of course, I'm not asking those who are not taking notes, because by now they have forgotten. So what's the first reason? Humble is the reason number two. Number one is resurrection. Allah is the one who created you from death. He can resurrect you back to life. Number two, humble yourself in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the third one is amazing. It's an OMG moment. It's actually this fluid or this blood clot. It seems to be purposeless. No value, no shape, no identity whatsoever. I remember when my wife, she had the first miscarriage. And she was probably 1 month pregnant. So she lost the alaq, that blood clot. And we saw it actually, and it was kind of cool to see that. That was, oh, that's Baba. You know, I was talking to be son. And we didn't know what to do to it. So, but subhanAllah, if you look at it and reflect, that Allah has made the human being from something that's purposeless, that's worthless, that's very tiny, meaning with no purpose, Allah made you this beautiful, handsome, smart, intelligent, amazing human being. So there should be a purpose. There should be a reason. You don't design something that's amazing and intricate as a human being, and then you keep it for nothing. Allah did not design you to spend 8 hours at the gym and just build muscles and muscles and muscles and that's it. There's something more from your creation. There's something. Allah has perfected your creation. Allah says when He talks about our creation in the womb, He says, فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ أَحْسَنُ الْخَالِقِينَ. Blessed is Allah, the best of creators. So Allah is treating us with ihsan when He created us. And when Allah is commanding us to worship Him, He says, لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. So that He may test you, which one of you is best indeed. So the one who treated you with ihsan, wants you to do ihsan to him. The one who perfected your creation and your manners and your mashallah, your beautiful, handsome, and everyone thinks mashallah, they are the best role models and what have you. Allah wants you to be perfect your ibadah to Him. Another profound meaning of mentioning the alaq. You know, human beings have three stages of development. The first one, when they are in the womb of their mom. The spirit stays for how many months? 9 months. Perfect. So at least we have someone still awake. 9 months, and the only one who can take care of you in this moment is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's feeding you, taking care of you, developing all your organs and everything, and mashallah, you are born as a perfect human being. The second stage of your development is when, from the moment of birth until the age of puberty. And who's responsible for you to raise you and educate you and what have you? Your parents. They will take care of you, know what, everything. And then there's a third stage. The third stage is what? After puberty. Which is you guys. You and me. Who's responsible for you? It's yourself. So there's no one there to take care of you. Now you are on your own. You have to go and start your path in life. And here's where Iqraa kicks in. Here's where Iqraa is important. Because you, after puberty, if you have no Iqraa, if you have no knowledge, you are not very different from that embryo that fell, you know, that fell and we flushed it into the toilet. You are no different. Why? Because you're a human being with no Iqraa. You are not staying. You are not developing. You do not do anything for yourself. With no Iqraa, I'm sorry to say, you are not different than a baby who is not potty trained. Because you are not spending the effort to teach and educate yourself. الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ عَلَقٍ اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم. Allah is the most honorable one because He gave you knowledge. He gave you the tools to read and write and educate others. So and then it says, علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. Allah has taught you everything. So, subhanAllah, I had to mention the اقرأ moment for a reason. It's because the ship of humanity is drowning again. As the brother said, a lot of wars, a lot of ignorance, a lot of crimes, a lot of misguidance. People are going in chaos. And the holes that the Prophet ﷺ and the generation and the Sahaba, they tried to, mashallah, make a super duper ship. Now it's being drowning again. And we want you. And Islam wants you. But the road for that starts with Iqraa. It starts with changing yourself. This reminds me of a Chinese story where they say that a man was sitting on his couch on a weekend, and he just wanted his moment of rest and relaxation. And the kid will say, and like my kid, blah, 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 I want to wait to play with you, and blah, 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 please play with me. And the man is, please, I want some my moment. So the man, what does he do? He was reading a newspaper that had the map of the world on it. So, you know, this very complicated map with all the details in it, Asia, Europe, all kinds of stuff. So the man tears that paper into small pieces. And he tells his kid, go and puzzle, put everything back in place to fix the map of the world. And he thinks that, yeah, he's going to make his kid busy for probably a couple of hours. The kid will go after 10 minutes. Dad, I'm done. What happened? What did you do? So the kid will say, when you were holding the newspaper from one side, there was the map of the world. But from the other side, there was the face of a little baby, little kid. So in order to fix the whole world, I had to only fix the baby. And when I fixed the face of the baby, the whole world was done. The idea is, if you want to change the world, start by yourself. Start by changing yourself, and wallahi, you will change the world. And if you want to start by yourself, the only way to do that is Iqraa. Is by Iqraa. That's why Iqraa is the best way. If you want to start praying and be consistent in your prayer and on time, Iqraa is the way for do that. If you want to stop watching porn, someone has a problem with addiction or stuff like that, Iqraa is your way. Because when you learn and when you educate yourself about facts and realities, inshallah, this will help you. If you want to wear the hijab, it's not an emotional moment where, you know what, it's cool to wear a hijab. You need Iqraa. You need knowledge. You need a foundation of knowledge. The brother talked about feeling the Islam high. It's not only that, it's not enough, because people take a lot of decisions when they are in a lecture, but then they forget about them when they leave. Why? Because there's no Iqraa. If you want to really stay closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Iqraa is your way to do that. If you want to reduce your dose of filthy music, Iqraa is your way. And Iqraa for both the Quran and for useful books. If you want to enhance your relation with your parents, Iqraa is your way. If you have an identity crisis, you're ashamed to be a Muslim, and you know what, you feel like you don't belong here, Iqraa, go and read about our history and about the Sahaba, and inshallah you'll become a better person. More importantly, Iqraa Bismi Rabbik, with the help of your Lord, for the sake of your Lord, and by the name of your Lord. MMYC, I love you guys, inshallah. I wish you have a great conference. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.